Welcome to Time Warp Radio Network. I'm Gemini, and today's date is Friday, September 21st, 2012. We are delighted to have Teal Scott, author of The Sculptor in the Sky, with us this evening. Teal is a spiritual catalyst, both accepting and utilizing her clairvoyant, clairsentient, and clairaudient abilities. She manipulates electromagnetic fields and has the ability to communicate with thought forms and reminds people of the united energetic nature of this universe. She teaches others how to create and find bliss in the midst of even the most extreme circumstances. You can learn more about Teal Scott at www.thespiritualcatalyst.com. Hello, Teal. Welcome to Time Monk Radio.
Thanks for having me so much.
Joining us from the Time Monk Radio Forum are Chipper Dog, Green Meadow, and Uranus Rising, as well as former guest Brian Mercer, co-author of Mastering Astral Projection. Teal, let's talk about the impetus for writing your book, Sculptor in the Sky.
Well, like all great arts, I guess it kind of happened upon me as an inspiration. I was just sort of sitting in the middle of the room, and I've always been a writer, totally compulsive writer, and I just got this impulse to sit down and just start writing the kind of stuff that I knew about, because I was beginning to see people on a daily basis who were coming to me for their life problems, which is something that I've done my whole life, but I started to become really upset at the fact that people were unwilling to prioritize happiness, and it came to my attention that until people knew why it was important that they prioritized happiness, they weren't going to do it. So I decided to write a book about it, and it flowed really fast, and it happened in 3 months, and I was done with it, and here we are today.
Well, I read your book, and I started off thinking that I'm going to highlight all the things that really resonate with me, and I found that I was highlighting the entire book, so it was very powerful and really resonated on a lot of levels. And so let's talk about some of those things that you discuss in there. Let's start with our emotions and how they guide us.
Okay, so your emotions are always telling you accurate, moment by moment, what your vibration is. So it's like when you hold an energetic vibration, which we all understand that human beings are vibrational in nature. Every being is vibrational in nature, and secondarily, they are physical. And so our emotions are like the physical reflection of what our vibration is. And your happiness happens in your life when you're vibrationally aligned with that which you would call your higher self or with source energy. And so the happier you feel, the more aligned you are, and the less happy you feel, the more unaligned you are. And what's dictating your vibration is your thoughts. So we could say that your emotions are your indication as to whether the thought you're thinking vibrates at the same frequency as your higher self or not. So it's like a compass. You could treat your emotions like a compass. And all day, every day, they're giving you accurate information in terms of whether you're going against the grain of your higher self or in line with your higher self. And obviously, being in line with your higher self is going to lead to a happy life. We all know that in the spiritual community. When you're in line with your higher self is when you're really acting like the truest version of yourself.
And how do we go on to create intentionally versus by default?
I would say that right there is the work of spirituality. It's figuring out which thought patterns of yours really reflect your true beliefs and what you want to have be true for you and which ones don't. And so I would say that the way to go about doing that is to question your thoughts. The most dangerous thing in the universe is an unquestioned thought. And when you start questioning your thoughts, you start realizing that truth is completely subjective. And when truth is completely subjective, then suddenly your life comes away from, I have to own up to some truth that's outside of me, and it becomes, what do I want to have be true? And once you move to that kind of a mentality, then it becomes quite easy to focus on something, make it become true for you, and have it reflect in the physical dimension. And we call that creating by deliberate creating versus creating by default. Meaning, so when you're coming in and creating by default, that means that basically you're adopting all kinds of thought patterns, whether they are beneficial or non-beneficial. They're not necessarily ones you decided on, they're just ones you adopted. Kind of like picking up a sticker burr when you're outside hiking.
Okay. And You know, in your book, you mentioned that awareness is waking up from a reality that you're creating by default. And I found that really interesting. Can you expound on that?
Yeah. So when you're living your day-to-day life, we could call this physical dimension which we're in just being deeper in a dream. So when you're outside of your body, you're in one level of the dream, and here in the physical reality, we're even deeper in the dream, meaning that it's even all of the vibrations that go into the physical dimension are solid enough to convince you that this is all that exists. And when you really start waking up, i.e. making your physical reality lucid, is when you start realizing that it is a dream, essentially. And then you can start doing things like you wouldn't lucid dream intentionally. Does that make sense?
It does. Thank you.
Hi, Teal. This is Green Meadow, and I have a question. You talk about making happiness a priority, and when I look at people, I watch people, and their motivation seems to be moving away from pain. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I know in my life I've started trying to move towards joy instead of being just triggered by pain. And that has created a much better life, certainly. And I can see that in other people as well, as they move towards joy rather than just away from pain. But there's this kind of pervasive idea that struggle is just part of life. And that pain is just part of life. And I'm wondering, as you go down this path, is struggle actually a stage, or can you move past it?
Oh, the answer is you can always move past it. Struggle is one of those parts of this matrix which we're in, basically, which is a default belief. And it helps people to see, a lot of times you can be in resistance to something, which is the same as creating it. So you could be in resistance to suffering. So the reason that people in the Eastern religions are so incredibly, they get a lot of good results basically out of getting people to accept that suffering is part of life, is because in acceptance, you are releasing resistance to something. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it's true. It just means that it's helping you release resistance. When you wake up even further, you realize that there's absolutely nothing that is fixed. Coming down to this life did not ensure that you would be suffering. A lot of times we like to joke about the fact that almost everybody who's a spiritual teacher is kind of buying into hypocrisy in a way, because on one hand we say we create our own reality, and on the other hand we say, oh, except for that suffering is just an inevitable byproduct of life. And it's like, well, which one is it? Because if you create your own reality the way you want it to be, suffering would not actually be included for the majority of people for whom they've experienced suffering, and it has, of course, given rise to desire within them to be free of it. It's not an inevitability at all. It's just, in fact, the better it gets, the better it gets. Meaning, the better you get it at giving rise to what you desire and lining up with what you desire, you don't experience the suffering. Suffering is just basically when you have already given rise to the desire, but you continue focusing on that which inspired the desire, which is usually contrast. So, for example, you're sitting in a relationship and you don't like the relationship. And that means you've already given rise to the idea of the perfect relationship, but you keep looking at what's wrong with your current relationship, even after you have delivered that idea into the universe. And that's the same as not letting yourself line up with what you yourself has created within this universe, which is the new improved idea. That is all that suffering is. And if that's absent, then it becomes a much more allowing state that humans are in, where we don't experience suffering. When we experience contrast, we just let it inspire us to the new idea and then light up with the new idea. When suffering comes in is when you hold yourself to the previous idea.
Teal, isn't that similar to what you just said about the default state, creating from the default state, and when you adopt other patterns that you don't have a greater hand in, that are not necessarily your basic state, so to speak, would that be where suffering comes in? Is where the idea you have of your state is different than it actually is?
Yes. So suffering is a default belief. Yes. Yes. But of course, getting out of your suffering requires a huge amount of questioning. It requires holding on to the beliefs which serve you, that's why we don't do a lot of work with positive beliefs here, because they're already working for you. The stuff that doesn't work for you is the negative stuff. So when you have a negative thought pattern, that's what you really want to be questioning. To the degree that you suddenly realize that that thought is pliable.
So, because certainly suffering, you can learn from suffering.
Oh, yeah.
And then how do you recommend, or what is the next stage? So if we choose to learn from something other than suffering, what are we learning from?
You'd be learning from contrast. Contrast is not the same thing as suffering. Suffering can be an aspect of contrast, but by contrast, all that means is what white is to black. So pain is to pleasure. It's just, suffering does not necessarily have to be part of contrast. You can just let it be what inspires the opposite. And then there won't be that tug of war going on. When we're talking about suffering, we're talking about that intense low vibrational state. But if you're looking at this as if it is just a dream, you're going to have the same kind of relationship to it that you do to a lucid dream, where it's not that big a deal that this person just died, because in reality they just left the movie theater. See?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is what really does it.
You find the, at least I find the greatest beauty when there is contrast.
Oh yeah. Oh, without it, you wouldn't. I mean, isn't your best meal eaten when you're hungry?
Yeah. Yeah.
But it doesn't mean you have to suffer. So, yeah, suffering is optional. It just doesn't feel that way in the moment. Otherwise, it wouldn't be suffering.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Teal, this is Brian. I'm just curious if you could talk a little bit about your early life and how you came into touch with your spirituality.
Oh, goodness. Okay. Well, I was born with all these different, I guess you could call them abilities. Back then, I used to see them as a curse. I didn't really know that the way that I saw the world was any different than how everybody else saw the world, but apparently it was. And I got a lot of crap for it when I was younger, and I ended up catching the attention of a cult, and then I was ritually tortured for 13 years. And while I had all of these abilities, it's kind of like having a lot of tools but no idea how to implement them. So I like to say that I was baptized by fire. I was given all the tools, but going through that suffering, ironically, it was suffering that baptized me. Going through all that suffering really led me to the higher truths, which you kind of are forced to do. I mean, if you're in a situation like I was, where you're completely imprisoned by another person, and you have no control, or what feels like no control over your life and no free will, it kind of forces your mind to look for the only positive that you can possibly find, which is good, because you don't have as much to attach to.
So when you were, how old were you if you first started to notice that you were different, you know, in terms of these abilities?
When my parents moved to Utah. Oh, they moved. So I'd say about 3 or 4. I think it was 4 when I entered preschool the first time. I became very aware of the fact that what I was seeing and saying was not normal because of the reactions I was getting. The adults in my life were really, really scared of the stuff that I was talking about instead of being curious. And that's just because the majority of the people where I grew up were part of a big religion. So they've already got their beliefs, and anything outside that box is relatively scary, and then they don't want it to be a part of their lives. And so that's when I first started thinking, something's really different / wrong with me.
So what were you experiencing? What were you seeing?
When I am looking at somebody, I don't see just skin. I see beyond skin. I can see the organ systems, bone structures, everything that you would consider under skin, I guess. It's sort of what is happening all the time with me when I'm looking at a body. And I'm also seeing all these complex magnetic and energetic fields that are creating a human being. So when you think a thought, I actually see that in patterns in the energy field. that are feeding the human body. And so that, of course, enables me to see how people are doing energetically, to understand what it is that they're thinking, to understand what kind of problems are feeding their body. And on top of that, I don't understand negative space. I have synesthesia also. So not understanding negative space means that there's no air in my life, I guess you could say. I had somebody explain to me that what most people see in between, let's say, you and whatever item is in front of you on the countertop is just clear, almost like the same color as glass. And to me, it's just this huge sea of energy that nothing can be indivisible from. It's impossible to separate yourself from this field because you are in and of this field. So it's kind of a blurry line, if no line at all, where you start and the cup ends.
Wow. You know? That's pretty intense. So can you tell right away when you see someone, I mean, if they're very negative or if they're just bad news, would you be alerted?
Instantly, yes.
Okay.
Well, you can see it on them, and to me it doesn't, instead of it carrying sort of stigma of bad, when I see somebody who's in that state, it's always because they're holding really negative belief patterns about themselves. And so when they start doing that, their frequency starts to decrease, they start to get weaker, and their whole reality starts to match that vibration. So that looks like other people that are negative to them. It looks like, you know, a victim and a murderer, any kind of circumstance that matches that particular vibration. So they're really creating it through their own focus on themselves. So it becomes less personal that way, but at the same time it is personal because they're an extension of me. That's part of what's most important about what I teach, is the fact that the way that I've come into this life enables me to not have the filters most people have, so I can see how it is impossible that you can do anything and not affect the totality of all that is. It's like a, you know, the analogy of the wing beat on the other side of the world affects you over here in America, and it's true. It's true for the whole universe. Just because our organs, which are super limited in terms of perception, aren't picking up on vibrations, there is not one thought you can think that does not affect the totality of what is. It's very hard for a three-dimensional mind to understand how that could be possible, that you could affect the totality of what is by just changing you, because you are all that is, but we are all that is. See, it's very confusing because it's not a... This universe does not operate in a three-dimensional way, but our brain does.
Right, we know it theoretically, but if you're experiencing reality like that through your perception while you're in the body, it's got to be, you can see that and be aware of it all the time.
Oh yeah, it makes life. It makes life simultaneously more beautiful, and also when you're focused not so nicely, it makes it 10 times worse.
Right, I can see why you would think at some point it was a curse.
Yeah. Well, like, I'll give you an example. When I was 13, I remember... See, when you're able to sense energy fields, it's a little bit harder to adopt typical human beliefs.
Sorry.
Why? What's the last one?
No, I just... I can relate very, very closely to that statement. I don't see these fields. I feel them. Mm-hmm. And it sometimes feels like I'm walking into walls when there's none around.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's very interesting. So when I was 13, I was driving in the car, and I remember... So, you know, when roadkill gets hit, let's assume that it's some small animal. People just leave it on the road, you know? And if you sense energy, you can't really differentiate between yourself and that skunk that's just been run over. And it starts to really weigh on you, the fact that there's... people that are so disconnected that they would do that. Because it's the same feeling for me, you know, driving past something like that as it would be for the majority of people driving over a human body until it's pulverized.
Yeah.
Yeah. So as a child, I was like, I want out of this. I was so suicidal. Oh my goodness. Because it's just too much. People are desensitized, so desensitized to their interconnectedness that it becomes a world full of perpetrators. Even the good guys are perpetrators.
We stumble around in our confusions.
Yes. And that's all it is. It's just a confused mind. And a confused mind needs to defend itself. And we call this the ego.
Teal, this is Uranus rising.
I heard in one of your interviews, you were speaking about your teens and whatnot, about when you were in this abusive situation. And I've come across many stories where people who are in abusive physical situations or great pain or torture, that they spontaneously have out-of-body experiences. Mm-hmm. Just because the pain is too much to bear. I wonder if you experienced that, and if you did, what did you experience? Was it helpful or insightful to you? And perhaps I'd like to know, hear a bit about how you coped with those experiences in your own way.
Okay. Yeah, I would say that the difficult part in my life is kind of the which came first, the chicken or the egg. I was going out of body before this whole stuff was happening. But what happened when I started getting into this abuse situation is that tactic I already had developed started to get out of my control. So you know how a lot of people say that it takes them a lot of focus to get out of body? Or I guess it takes them some amount of effort to... Mm-hmm. Detached from the physical dimension. For me, it's exactly the opposite, and I definitely think that a good case could be made as to that being, of course, a byproduct of my abuse in my childhood, because it's what anybody does. I mean, that's just, literally everybody goes out of body because this is how it works. And we call it, see, and it's varying degrees of out of body, because the primary, the very first out of body experience we call dissociation. It's not full separation, so you will never hear that pop, you'll never hit the vibrational stage, but you'll begin to dissociate with your own mind, and that's the state that most victims of any kind of abuse go into, and so we just say there are varying degrees to which a person goes out of body when they're abused, but they always do to some degree, because when you're forced into a situation where you can't fight and you can't run, that means that your fight or flight response is nullified. Your brain has one option, and that's to detach. So it does. And I spent just tons and tons of time at the various levels out of body, meaning in the fourth dimension, you're basically just watching yourself. It's almost like an energy, I almost want to call it like a blueprint, because even though colors aren't the same sometimes, it's just like this dimension. It just is like the energetic level of what you're living in right now. So it doesn't look that much different, but you're watching your own body.
Is that sort of like what people see in a near-death experience?
Yes.
Okay.
But past that, now we're going out to, you know, fifth, sixth dimensional level. Uh-huh. And let's just say that the bars come off a bit, and and then it becomes, oh, now I'm at the other side of the world. Oh, now I don't even know what galaxy I'm in. Now I don't even feel like I have an identity. We're just going out and out and out until I remember the times that I got seriously, seriously tortured. Like, you know, the kind of stuff where I'd be put out, and the pain was bad enough in terms of what I was going through that I just was, it was like a near-death experience, basically. I ended up going out to my favorite. We could call this the ultimate dimension, where there's no space, there's no time, there's no separate identity, it's not even an identity, there's no conceptualization of what you are or aren't, it's just a complete state of being. It's totally an impossible thing to describe. It's being, it's of course matching up with who you really are. And it's so fabulous. It's a level of peace that is just indescribable, but I can tell you it makes coming back 10 times worse, because once
I can imagine, yeah.
Yeah, it's like of course, it's like taking somebody in Africa and bringing them over to see one of our grocery stores. It's like, oh, great, I'm going to have a time going back now.
yeah. So it sounds like you learned a lot by doing that then.
Oh, yeah, tons and tons. I love it. It's a good tool. It's a fabulous tool. Because when you're unrestricted by your own identity, everything gets super fun. This becomes more of a game. And I want to say, though, at first it doesn't feel good. It's like at first when you realize that all of this is a total game, it's kind of a, I want to get out of the matrix, you know?
Yeah.
After a while, when you settle into it a bit and you realize that it's not like you're plugging into an external reality, you're actually creating it, then it's like really fun. It's the same, you have the same feeling towards life as you have towards creating a painting. What I can do.
Amazing. So, given that you were able to access these states, what did you discover and bring back that has helped and facilitated your work?
Well, getting out of this matrix, let's just call it a matrix, getting out of the matrix basically makes it so that when you come back in, you're not running the rat race anymore. Which when all is said and done, though I wouldn't want to repeat what I went through, I think it's the most valuable gift that I could have possibly asked for. I would never take it back, because all unhappiness has to do with running someone else's rat race. You're not even doing it because of intrinsic motivation. You're doing it just because you think you should. And when you come down here and you recognize the rat race for what it is, you step outside the box to such a degree that you can find joy for the first time. And when you really taste that and you realize that most people have never tasted that, it becomes very important for you, knowing the oneness that is, to help all aspects of you line up with that emotion and that feeling and that state of being. Which is the real reason that most enlightened beings come back and help people, is because you can't recognize oneness and then say, oh good, I'm just going to go chill out for all of time and eternity. If there's even one aspect of you that is not in alignment, then that's an aspect of you that's not in alignment. So it becomes a personal thing, coming back and helping people find their own version of that freedom and joy.
Yeah, it sounds like the Buddhist Bodhisattva vow that I can't be enlightened until all are enlightened.
It's true.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Teal, when you were talking about where you'd go to when the 3D got excessive, were you at all able to contact those people who were performing that torture on you's higher selves and saying, what is going on?
I never did, no.
Okay.
Because, see, the higher self is always feeding energy into what you would consider your separate physical self. But really, you can't call it a separate physical self because it is an extension of the higher self. You would cease to exist if it wasn't for the self feeding you its energy. So you can think of human beings kind of like beams of light. The beam of light is inseparable from the light source because it's all light. But because there is so much energy that's focused into a physical being, the physical being is a thought which now thinks, and because it now thinks, it can hold an opposing thought to the thought which first created it. And that is what's happening when we're thinking any thought which does not resonate with our higher selves. So when these people get themselves to the point in their life where they feel that level of disconnection, they're holding thoughts which make it so that their higher selves can't even reach them vibrationally in terms of, you know, telling them this is right versus wrong. Because even though that information is being fed, it's been resisted for so long that that's now the dominant state of the human being.
Okay, so they've channelized their thought process physically, and it can't resonate at that higher frequency.
Yeah,
well, what it sounds like.
And if they keep thinking the way that they are thinking, but I didn't ever actually interact with their higher selves directly. No, I usually was interacting with my guides when I was out of body.
Yeah. Well, thanks.
Could you tell us about your guidance, Teal?
Oh, yeah. So my principal guide, who's probably my favorite, he goes by the name Veldon Dali. He's like a little Phoenician monk, I guess you could say. He's been with me since the very beginning. A few of them have. So when I go out of body a lot, we have conversations together, and I go visit him in his fourth dimensional scape, which is mine as well. I guess it's a co-creation.
Do you have different guides in different dimensions?
You have different guides that correspond to different dimensions. Yeah.
Okay.
So like a lot of people have light bodies, and that's basically as high of a thought form as you can get. It's as high a frequency thought form. That's what people are calling angels.
Yeah.
It's just a super high frequency guide, and they have different stuff to teach you. I mean, so some, let's say that you have like an archetypal guide. The Phoenician monk would be an archetypal guide. He's picked image. Both of us have co-created an image for him, which relates to my intention in this life. That's why he comes being like that. And so he shares the vibration of that matches my intention. But a higher order guide, one of those light bodies, you could say, they exist on such a huge, such an expansive dimension that they don't even think that it's appropriate to talk about identity at all. So they don't come across as male or female. They won't come across as having a name, nothing.
Yeah. I can see that. Do you sense colors? I mean, I've heard very dark purple at the higher you go, you know, the greatest that we have access to. Or is your experience different?
In my experience, when you get to the ultimate dimension, there's no such thing as color.
Ah, I love that. Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, great. Thank you.
So let's say that, well, we could say that black is the highest you can go, because that is the when all colors are one. So all colors are one, you're in black, and that would be the highest dimension that you can go to, which point you will no longer perceive anything based to physical life like color.
Well, I can tell you're a painter by that statement. You've mixed all your colors together. Oh, that's great. By the way, maybe you could say something about your paintings as well. I've seen them on your site, and they're quite beautiful. How do you paint?
I feel kind of like I cheat doing what I do, honestly, because I see these. Okay, you know how? Here's an explanation. If you hold up like a white sheet of paper, and then no, let's not do that. Don't even hold up white. Let's say that you are looking at an object. You hold it in front of you, and then if you close your eyes, you'll notice that if you're looking at the back of your eyelid, there's still an impression of that image.
Mm.
So when I am looking at somebody, let's say that they were going to think a thought which made them give rise to the pattern of excitement. Now, I'm able to look at a white paper, and that imprint of what I'm looking at in terms of excitement is still there. So it almost is like an outline in and of itself for me. So then I trace the outline of these patterns that I'm watching in the energy fields. And then I'm filling them in with color where the color goes.
Wow. Wow. So it's almost, I get the image. Yeah. Or a coloring book where it's all outlined for you. And
yes,
then you put in paint by numbers. Yes, Jibberdong.
Well, I think I love doing it. And I love the fact that it really benefits people. It super benefits them because they're allopathic paintings. It's just, sometimes I'm like, oh, if people really knew. I'm just like tracing crap.
That's wonderful. Oh, and I'm so pleased to hear that they're helping people.
Wow. Oh, yeah. Oh. I love doing them. I'm a hopeless artist. I can't stop creating. Everyone in my house just laughs about it because I'm just like a whirling dervish. If I'm not creating something, I implode. So.
So that must speak strongly of what your purpose is then.
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah.
Great.
Just so awesome. See, that's what I want for everybody. What I want for everybody is to understand that your purpose cannot ever be separate from your joy. So doing that thing you love doing is exactly what you're meant to be doing here. And getting paid for it is a bonus. It gets to the point where you start to feel like, oh, my gosh, this is just ridiculous. You know, according to society, if they knew what this was like, it would be criminal. I'm doing what I love doing and what I would do even if I didn't get paid and what I would do even if I had all the money in the world. And I'm getting paid for it.
Amazing. Amazing.
Yeah. But that right there is how everyone intended to live. So it's not like some of us get to get lucky and live lives like that. If everybody comes into alignment, then you can live a life exactly like I'm describing.
Well, it sounds like I think Joseph Campbell used to speak of it. Follow your bliss.
Mm.
Yeah.
Most important words ever spoken to the English language.
Lovely.
See, if you follow your bliss, nothing can go wrong. So that really is the wisest statement of all. It's not follow your bliss and you'll finally be happy. No, it's follow your bliss and every single thing that you want is going to come into alignment.
Teal, I want to touch on that a bit about the bliss. And you mentioned in your book, you will not find your bliss in the act of others agreeing with you. Can you touch on that?
Well,
And then how does that speak to co-creation?
Co-creation is just that we're going to come down here and agree on a vibration because we're both learning from it. But you're never going to get two people to agree. It's just not going to happen because it defies the reason that the third dimension was created in the first place. This was created to become a mirror for one person and one person only, and that's you. It's just from the highest of perspectives, that's really easy to do. To make it so that everyone's reality is the only reality is super easy from that dimension. And so down here in the third dimension, it's like we don't understand that everything, every single thing in our reality is just something we've created. And if somebody else is experiencing the same thing, it's because we're co-creating it at this moment. Because co-creating it serves us in some way. Whether it's to make the contrast more intense or, you know, whatever it is, it always serves a purpose. But understanding that the universe that you live in individually is just a mirrored reflection of your own vibration means that if you're trying to go around and get everyone else to agree with you, then it comes from the space of not feeling confident enough to go in your own direction on your own. So it really comes from a negative vibration. If you get into the space of joy, it really will cease to matter whether somebody agrees or disagrees with your opinion. So if we're going around looking for people to agree with us, we're just going to look for suffering. Because our looking comes from an idea that you need that to be happy, and need is lack, and so obviously you're focused on lack, and that's all you can get. So it's like a dead-end street.
Okay, thank you.
Am I making this too complicated?
No, not at all.
It's really difficult to explain how this works because we're dealing with a... I guess any time you talk about multiple dimensions, it's a little bit difficult because your brain kind of starts grinding itself to try to align with an understanding which it was not designed to understand.
Okay, thank you. So, Teal, when you're talking about following your bliss, I've noticed that it's become, I guess we're so disassociated or whatever, that it's hard to feel or find bliss because we can't even recognize it.
Yeah, well, we complicate it.
Yeah.
Because from where most people stand, they stand in an aspect of such powerlessness that they've never tasted what bliss is. Most people on this planet have not tasted what bliss is. So to talk about bliss is fine and dandy, but nobody's going to get it, which is the real problem that a lot of people have is how do you bridge the gap between where people are and where these ascended masters are, you could say. Most ascended masters talk about things which the human mind at its current state can't comprehend, so it's not really beneficial. So
yeah.
So when I say bliss, that means relative to where you are. So the word we're really looking to replace bliss with is relief. Because from a state of revenge, anger feels like relief. From a state of anger, pessimism feels like relief. And so pessimism is a step in the direction of bliss from a space of anger. Just like hope is a step in the direction of bliss when you have been in anger.
Yeah, that's so different than the advertised of if you have $1 million, you'll be happy. Yeah, that's a very different thought.
Yes. Yeah, nobody's going to align with happiness and end up broke, you see. But the minute that you take care of the house, you get yourself into trouble. And that's really what we try to do here with happiness. Instead of just let ourselves go in the direction of what feels good, which is as simple as this life really is, we tend to do things like, okay, well, I want happiness, but happiness is going to come through this one person that I have been feeling feelings towards. Or happiness is going to come through getting $1 million in the bank. But that's the same as controlling the how. And that's not your job, that's the job of the universe. Your job was to come down here and decipher, because of this contrasting environment, what is it that you want. And once you have told the universe what you want, it's the universe's job to to mold the matrix around your thoughts.
Okay, so then here's a question. If someone's had a lot of pain in their life, then basically what you're saying is the way to happiness is trusting the universe. And if you've had a lot of pain in your life, that's not like the first thing that comes to mind.
Oh, hell no, and we would never make it be, because they can't lie to themselves and say they trust something they don't trust. But we can put it to them like this. You may have had a lot of suffering in your life, but guess what? It's over and done with, and nothing's going to make it better. You can't ever go back and undo something which has been done. So your only point of power is right now where you stand, what would feel a little bit better. You only have one decision from anywhere you are, and that is better or worse. It's that simple. Better or worse? Does this thought feel better or worse? Does this action feel better or worse? Does this thing coming out of my mouth feel better or worse? And if the answer is better, then that's the direction you go. And incrementally, you'll notice that that gets better and better and better until better or worse is really good stuff, where back when better or worse was, you know, not so great.
But, yeah, in my personal life, I've gotten better and better and better, and part of me is still waiting for the other shoe to drop.
Oh, yeah. That's a default belief. I talk to many people who have that same one.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of you're waiting, you've been told that that which climbs to great heights must fall. And that right there is a negative expectation. You're creating the reality to reflect exactly what you're thinking, when that really doesn't have to be how it is. But there are many people who think that way, and the reason that they keep... So you know right now in your shoes that that is not a beneficial belief. The problem is, it still benefits you. See, when you can look at your reality and say, oh, the other shoe is going to fall, at least you know it's going to fall, and you're not going to get blindsided and disappointed. And so it's still serving you to prevent what you're considering greater injury, which is the disappointment and the fall when you weren't expecting it.
Mm.
So once people who are in that state can get to the point of sort of realizing that it's serving them in that way, and then realizing that it's not worth what it does, then you can incrementally let go of it. It's just important to note that the only reason you still have the belief, and though you know it doesn't serve you, is because it actually does.
Yeah, it's... how to be kind to the immature thought that's trying to protect you.
Well, because it's precious that it's trying to protect you.
Yeah. See,
it should take the wind out from underneath its wings.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at yourself and say, oh, that's so sweet that I care about me enough and my own happiness enough that I'm wanting to prevent myself from being blindsided. See,
yeah.
Observing your thoughts is everything, because the problem is not the thoughts themselves. The problem is believing the thoughts. That's what I call joining with a thought pattern versus observing a thought pattern. And when you're observing your thought patterns, it's much easier to see the non-validity of them. And then you just start doing that in the moment. So at first it starts, oh, I'm recognizing that pattern. And then you do it, you know, 3-4 more times and you don't notice till afterwards. But pretty soon there comes that point where you realize you're doing it in the moment. And that's your moment of truth. Am I going to... In the moment, I can hear these words leaving my mouth, or these thoughts leaving my head. Am I going to align with that or not? And the minute that you are in that decisive space, you've won. It's literally, you've won. That's it. So you just keep doing that, and then you start replacing the thought, and pretty soon the neurotransmitters set themselves up around that new thought, and pretty soon you're like, wow, I cannot believe I ever thought that way.
Yeah. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Teal, one of your talks, you talked about that you thought that people feeling disempowered was one of the biggest challenges we face. Could you speak of that, maybe say why you think that, and what suggestions you might have to resolve that and to let go of it?
Powerlessness is the most damaging vibration that we hold. It is behind every problem we have on this planet. So what you would consider war is coming from the feeling of powerlessness. What you're looking at and calling child abuse is because of powerlessness. Everything that we can't stand collectively as a human is because of that vibration. Fear is an aspect of powerlessness, and it is the exact antithesis vibration to that which is source energy.
Mm.
And that's why we would call it the most damaging vibration that there is, because a person who is in an aspect of powerlessness either becomes a victim or acts out on that powerlessness in attempt to move up the scale, which revenge, I'm sorry to say this, because I'm not really sorry to say it, but you know, a lot of people don't like the fact that I say this, but I'm able to see vibration. So I can literally tell you, vibrationally, revenge is a higher vibration than powerlessness. So you have these people who are powerless, and in their powerlessness, they desire to not feel powerless. And so the next logical step for them is a thought that feels like revenge. And mm-hmm. But because they're not taught to go past that thought of revenge, they act out from the vibrational space of revenge, and that looks like murder. So
right.
Everything that we are not liking about this world is because of the person feeling powerless.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So by exercising revenge, you're actually exercising some sort of power as a step out of the space of powerlessness. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. And there we have, again, not a very popular teaching. As far as the universe is detached from death. Let's just go there. It doesn't see death any more intensely as you do walking in and out of a movie theater. And so, with regards to these really heinous things, we would tell you we would rather have you be in a vibration of revenge than be in a vibration of victimhood and power and powerlessness. It's just that you don't have to act out. You don't have to take action from this vibrational state. And if people have been taught and knew themselves how to move into the thought that feels like revenge, move into the thought then that feels like anger, move into a thought that feels like hope, they would be able to get themselves past these vibrational states and then take action from a positive vibrational state instead of a negative vibrational state.
So I just want to make sure I understand what you're saying, so I'm going to repeat it a little bit. So instead of feeling powerless or disempowered, move into a state of revenge or anger or something along that line that has some energy behind it, some power.
Yes.
Don't act on it, but use it to get you out of that mental state.
Yes.
And then you're able to make better decisions or move forward or make better choices. Is that what you're – did I get that right?
Well, it's much easier than that, because it really doesn't need to be any of us thinking about taking action at all, because the pervasive law in this universe is the law of attraction. I mean, we've all heard about the law of attraction, but we don't understand how awesome this is. The law of attraction makes it so no action you can take can ever match anything other than the state you take the action from. That's a vibrational law. So if you get yourself into the vibration of feeling good, any action you're inspired to take is going to have a beneficial result. You don't need to take effort. It's just, it's inspired within you.
And that sounds like just not repressing anything and just going with what our natural state of being would be.
Yeah, it's just climbing the vibrational scale. That's all you're doing. Yeah. But this is, of course, what society has told people never to do. I mean, anybody who condones a negative, especially angry thought, we are chastised into guilt for, and guilt is a lower vibration. This is really, I mean, we're causing our worst nightmare. Mm-hmm. We're in a situation where people are born into powerless situations. They feel more powerless, and they go to the next natural step, which is revenge and anger. But the society they live in says, anger's not good, don't feel anger. And instead of bringing them forward, it pushes them back into powerlessness.
Yeah, and depression, and it's internalized.
Oh, and when it's internalized, they get stuck there for only so long before that energy has to go somewhere. And that energy is taken out on someone else.
Yeah. And then moving, okay, somebody becomes spontaneous and just acts as they normally would. And then that attracts more positive powers. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah.
And then you get out of that state, right?
Oh, yeah. So you'll notice
Okay.
In your negative state, you'll notice that the thought, it's really hard to think a positive thought. But if you force your focus to orient towards something positive, you'll notice that they start to come easier and easier and easier and easier. And that's because the law of attraction is lining you up with thoughts that resonate at the same frequency as that original thought.
Mm.
When it reads.
Yeah. Well, it just seems like somewhere we got lost being human somewhere along the line. And also, you know, what you just described sounds like moving out of a victim state to a mentality.
Oh, yeah.
And then we're told if we do that, then we're a bully or, you know, this and that. So
that's because humans don't trust themselves. We don't trust our inherent good nature. And so we're convinced that if we don't punish ourselves, we're going to be the most horrible people that are alive. And what a beneficial belief that is.
I'm just thinking about primitive cultures. They don't buy into all this stuff. And, you know, they just act spontaneously, and we call them uncivilized. But how much do you think this is just the Piscean age, perhaps? Maybe we're trying to move out of that with good guides like you around.
Well, of course, it's a collective intention. So that is exactly what this age is about.
Mm-hmm.
Coming into further awareness so that you can create what you want to create, so you realize you are an extension of God Force energy, basically. That's what this is all about. It's just everybody's more or less connected in some ways and not in other ways. So your indigenous cultures tend to be much more in connection with, you would consider it an instinct in them, ironically enough, an instinct. But that's an aspect of being in alignment. They're much more sensitive to their internal knowings, whereas we could say the Western world has been very swayed to put stock in beliefs and take stock out of what you feel.
Mm-hmm.
So we've broken everyone's compass, and now we're expecting life to go good, but now we just have to put more controls in place. But the more controls we put in place, the more we say, I don't trust you, to people, and the more they don't trust themselves. And so the more, see how this is a collapsing flat in the cupboard?
Yeah. Well, do you think we need to collapse in order this mentality to collapse so we can start again?
Well, it's hope quite fast.
Wonderful.
I don't think it's necessary. We'll put it that way. It's not necessary, but it is a potential on the human life path for this whole system to collapse first for people to find alignment, and that's okay. It's just the reason I wouldn't come down here if I was like, I mean, if I really thought that things needed to collapse first, then I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. Instead, I'd be coming down here and probably shooting people and, like, helping them align with what collapse looks like. But I think it's possible before you hit ground to sort of catch yourself before you hit and say, wait a minute, this doesn't feel good. Now, if I can get a person to that point, then they can find alignment regardless of having not hit rock bottom, which is, of course, the goal.
Yeah. Oh, I'm with you. Wonderful. Thanks, Teal.
Yeah.
Can I break in and just ask a question, Teal, about if you are working in this fashion, and say I'm trying to work in this fashion, and Susan's trying to work in this, so Uranus is trying to work in this fashion, and other people are working in this fashion, does that accumulate force? Does that increase the vibrational state of that working in that fashion?
Oh, yeah, because what is society and what is the totality of the human race? It is individuals. One of my favorite things is the saying about how did the oceans get created, drop by drop. So if you change yourself and he changes himself and the other person changes themselves, it only takes everyone doing it individually before the totality changes. And now we have a whole new human race. And in fact, individual by individual is literally the only way to go about doing that, because everybody has will. So you can't change the totality. You have to just attack it. It's not even attack. It's you have to reach one person, and that's it. And ironically, see, this is where it gets super fun, though. So I could talk a lot about the fact that I'm just reaching, you know, this person and that person and that person, but it's all me. So ultimately, the way you change the totality of all that is, including the mass human population, is one person, and that's your only responsibility, and that's you.
Yeah.
So my only responsibility in my life is me, and sometimes that looks like a responsibility to somebody who's on the side of the street. Sometimes it looks like doing a radio show. But the responsibility is self-love, all the time, every single time.
Yeah.
That's the only thing we're ever working on. Does that make sense, or do you want me to elaborate?
No, it does. I just, the conscious joining together of, like, minding individuals of that nature, realizing that we each work on our own self and we uplift that which we are aware of, makes so much sense.
We have to take our teeth out of the idea that there's some sort of a reality which exists separate from us. If we say we create our own reality, which we do, what that means is, it doesn't matter whether you or I are having a conversation, my voice coming through this computer right now is nothing but your projection. Everything in your reality is a projection of your mind. That's all that exists. So once you get there, it gets pretty easy to say, oh crap, well, all I need to do then is to really love myself, and then by product I will be loving everything that is, and then that's a pure state of unity, and that's the highest vibration that there is. See, if you have even one aspect of resistance, like one tiny aspect, even if it's to war or to child molestation, if you have one aspect of resistance to anything, you are at war with yourself. That's very difficult for people to accept, of course, because who the hell wants to release resistance to things that are human atrocities, but an aspect of ourselves?
Yeah.
Any form of resistance is a function of the singular identity which we call ego. And ego's not good or bad, it's just the illusion of separation.
I see. Well, thank you.
Teal, I have a question for you. I wondered if this is Brian. I wondered if you could offer practical advice on just going forward on a day-to-day basis on how to align with the higher source. What is the most effective way to do that?
Okay, all day, every day. That is thinking about what it looks like to love yourself. That's it. If you really want, we could talk about everything. We could talk about a million different ways to go about this. But if you want the shortcut, which is fastest way from point A to point B, it is, how do I figure out how to love myself all day, every day? So that looks like a moment-to-moment choice. My favorite one is a process that I tell people to use, which is when you're in the moment, you ask yourself, what would someone who loved themselves do? The answer to that question is always in alignment with your higher self. And if you keep asking that question, you're not going to atrophy. Instead, you will be brought to every universal truth that can possibly exist.
Shortcut was actually the what I had in mind, yes. But so you're just saying is, so what you're, I'm thinking if I follow this advice, I would, I don't know, I'd be eating a lot of donuts.
You would, wouldn't you?
Well, I don't know. I don't know.
So, of course, that implies distrust. But, so here's how it works. From where you are, maybe self-love does look like a donut, but now you've eaten the donut, and now you get to pay attention to how you feel relative to eating the donut, and that will be your indication as to whether that is in line with self-love or not. But if you really ask yourself, what would someone who loved themselves do when you're pulled up next to the counter, most likely your answer is not going to be donut. See, sometimes it will, sometimes it won't, but the human mind doesn't enjoy those kinds of things. It enjoys black and white. It enjoys all donuts are always bad all the time, no holds barred. And all fruit is good all the time and no holds barred, but that's not how it works. So if you ask yourself, what would someone who loved themselves do, the impulse you're going to get is in line with you, because the answer you're getting is coming from your higher self. Your higher self is aware of every level in your body, all of the protein levels, all of your hormone levels. And so it's going to know exactly what you're standing in front of that is a match to self-love.
So what you're saying is we don't have to always necessarily be mindful and in the moment. We don't have to clear our thoughts. It's really about self-love and being in that vibration as long as we, as in a sustained way as we can.
Yes. Questioning your thoughts just makes it easier to stay in a vibration of self-love. I mean, self-love is the fast track. There is no faster fast track to everything you're looking for, whether it be awareness or enlightenment or happiness, whatever it is, there is no faster track than self-love. It's just, when we say self-love, today that might mean to you apple or an orange, or donut and an orange, or, you know, whatever decision. But later on, it looks like Do I resist this perpetrator who has a gun in my face? Or do I allow them? See, that when it gets really big here, when you start getting the answers to what somebody would love themselves to, you start realizing there's no separation between you and anything. So then you turn into what you would consider a spiritual guide slash master, because you're walking around the earth in a state of such acceptance and such self-love that love, obviously, if you understand that you're an extension of all that is, which you will eventually, then you can't have resistance towards anything. So it would be highly unlikely you'd line up at that point with somebody having a gun in your face, but, you know.
Thank you.
We are speaking with Teal Scott. You can visit Teal's website, www.thespiritualcatalyst.com, where you can learn more about Teal's approach to living and creating a life of bliss. You can also find Teal's book, The Sculptor in the Sky, at all good bookstores and online retailers. Teal, I have a question for you on, I'm trying to think of the best way to phrase this, on when you're a mother and you're worried about your child, or, you know, say they're driving age or they're small and you have a pool in your backyard, and the typical worry that comes with being a parent, how do you not manifest that versus the child, and say it's an older child that is in alignment with its highest vibration? How do those two competing thoughts meld, I guess is the best way to ask it. Does that make sense?
Well, basically, when it comes to children, it doesn't matter what age they are. They always are being talked to and trying to find alignment with their higher selves, and that's really not something that you have control over. What you can do as a parent is allow them to align with that to the highest degree that they can. So that looks like demonstrating what it looks like to be in alignment, demonstrating how, you know, mommy always does what she feels is right, I guess, you know. Teaching people to pay attention to their own internal guidance system is the most important thing you can do for children. So that's that part of it, which is the easy part. The not so easy part is deciding whether actions you're taking are making you line up with the problem or the solution. So right now where we stand, the majority of women are not going to feel good if they have an open pool in the backyard. I could tell you right now, if you literally believed that wasn't going to happen, it couldn't happen. It wouldn't be a vibrational match to you. And it wouldn't matter if it was a vibrational match to the child. The child couldn't come in, and it couldn't be part of your experience if they were a vibrational match to it, you see, because you're not. So you're creating your reality, which means if you believe the child would not fall into an open pit, they wouldn't. But chances are you're not going to, given your stock that you've put in the physical dimension, just jump that hurdle and automatically believe that. So then it becomes, how do I release resistance to this thought? So for some people that looks like putting a fence up around the pool, which is fine, only if it doesn't help you align with the problem. See, this is where it becomes very personal, because a mother basically gets to decide. Does putting a fence up make it so that I no longer have to worry about that, or does putting a fence up make it so that I'm doing nothing but focusing on the potential of them getting hurt? And that's a totally individual choice. So I would say do anything that helps you release resistance. So whether that's putting a fence up or not, that's what you want to be doing. And that's going to help it so that your focus isn't on what's going to go wrong, and so you can't be a match to it manifesting in a situation that's wrong. Is that sort of what you were asking?
Yes, and that's very helpful. I appreciate that answer. Thank you.
I use this in my own life all the time. See, it's not like I'm going to sit here and pretend that my vibration is totally perfect all the time. I have a 3-year-old, and the second that I had this 3-year-old and loved him to the degree that I have, I was like, oh my gosh, the worst thing in the whole universe would be losing a child. I don't care what kind of crap happened to me as a kid. The worst thing on earth is losing a child. It is. So, you know, I have my own aspect of resistance relative to that. So even I employ this technique. It's just looking at your reality. You're going to create whatever you are focused on. So how do you not focus on something? Sometimes that means so putting a seatbelt on is an example of releasing resistance to a crash. Sometimes if you put a seatbelt on, it's like, oh, if we get in a crash, it's fine. So I don't have to focus on getting in a crash. But for other people, taking that precaution and putting a seatbelt on actually is like, oh, crap, that made me just realize how dangerous this is, which is making it so that I'm going to focus on the crash the whole time and line up with it. So it's just all about the individual person. What is it going to take for you to feel better about the situation? Because that's all that matters. That's why we could say, and this is how it works all the time, even when we're talking like health cures, like chemotherapy. Chemotherapy in and of itself is neither here nor there. If anything, it's detrimental. But if somebody believes that they're going to get better with chemotherapy and thus releases resistance to the disorder, then it's not even about the chemotherapy, it's about the belief they're going to line up with health. So everybody has to decide from where they are what it's going to take for them to feel a little bit better about whatever it is that they're feeling negative focus about. See, but people don't like that, of course, because we've just made it individual again. You know, there's no, like, right or wrong answer. Everybody should remove the pool, the fence around the pool, because all that is aligning with what's negative. But it's much more shady and gray area than that.
Okay, that's really helpful. And, you know, if we could switch gears a little bit, and I'm sure this probably ties in somewhere, is karma and how I hear so much about that and how we come into this life to make up for misdeeds in another life or to complete a lesson where we caused harm or something like that. Could you speak to that?
You've come into this planet to be punished, right? That is the great idea when it comes to karma.
Right.
Yeah, karma. Interesting human concept. It's a misinterpretation of the law of attraction. It's a misinterpretation of vibrations match. So if you're focused on powerlessness, you're going to be a perfect match to somebody who reinforces your powerlessness. We don't understand how the law of attraction applies beyond our life, but it's pervasive all the time. So this is how it really works. You live a life and you experience a perspective, and because of that perspective, the higher you, you know, your higher self, which is not really higher, but let's just call it a higher self because we understand that concept. The eternal version of you is aligned to become the expansion, which was created through that life. Now you die, you rejoin source perspective, and you're in that pure positive energy because you have just aligned with everything that you have expanded to because of the life you've just lived. But from that expanded perspective, now you get to decide to expand more. So you may set forth an intention, something like, let's see what that perspective looks like. So once you cast forth that intention starts to draw in all necessary ingredients that are a match to that particular vibration. So your genetics are a match to your original intention. Everything about you, your star sign, the parents you're born to, all of it is attracted based on that original intention. And now you've intentionally created this kind of a life for you. And it's always to serve your expansion, but it's a deliberate choice. There is nobody that's in the sky there who is saying, oh, guess what? You killed something in your past life, so you get to be killed in this life. It's just not how it works, but you might opt into that because it's a beneficial thing for your own perspective. But people like to use karma as a scapegoat. And it's understandable why somebody would do that, because you're in an underprivileged area in India and you can't get out of your situation and you've just lost your third child. It's like, you better come up with something. Otherwise, you're going to implode. And so coming up with something looks like, okay, I'm going to accept this because it must be just penance for something I did in a past life. That's a hell of a lot better thought than this is happening for no reason. I have no control. This life is just a hellish life, and I want to get out. So the improved thought is something like, I did something to deserve this.
So accepting karma is creating by default.
Yep.
Okay, that makes sense.
And what we're really talking about in terms of karma really has nothing to do with blame either. It's like when you focus in a way, you're going to attract anything that's a match to that focus. It's just kind of sad to watch because this is what we mean when it rains, it pours. I know that everybody who's listening to this radio show has had an interaction with somebody where it's just like, okay, they've lost their child, and then the next week their dog dies, and the next week they lose their house, and it's like you're kind of going, are you kidding me? I couldn't even take a breath. And the reason that that's happening isn't because the universe hates them, isn't because it's picking on them. It's because their vibration is so heavily negatively focused that in this type of a design, the way the third dimension was designed, they can only line up with other things that are a match to whatever they're focusing on. that's why when it rains, it pours. And so we could look at that and say, oh, it's karma. And it does in the moment when you're in an aspect of powerlessness, feels like there's someone else picking on you. I mean, I'll be the first to admit that. Even given what I came into this life knowing, when I was in the situation I was in as a child, I was like, what the hell did I do to deserve this? You know? Because
yeah.
Where else are you going to go with the thought? That's just the natural byproduct thought of children, I guess. I mean, we're all raised with the understanding that if you're good, you deserve good things, and if you're bad, you deserve bad things. Automatically, that changes to when you grow up as an adult. If bad things are happening to me, it means I deserve it. And we've used karma as a life-to-life excuse, basically, to explain that emotion.
And religion certainly plays into that as well. Yeah.
Definitely does.
Could karma be looked at as a concept to help learn the self-responsibility necessary, the self-love necessary to transcend that concept?
It could, except for the problem is that there would have to be somebody else deciding that everyone down here on Earth had to catch up to a perspective of perfection which didn't exist in the first place. So when if the universe was to say, you all go down and learn how to come into self-love, which is what I am and what I already know that I am, and now you have to catch up to the perfection of that which I am. That's the old model of God. But let's get even more transcendent. When we go out to the ultimate dimension, we realize that there's no end result there. We are literally in a continual, eternal process of expansion. The universe has not decided for you what perfect is. The universe has not decided that self-love is perfect. It just has a good idea right now, given what it's been through, that what it is self-love. That is the vibration of Source. So when you live, right, you're happy, and when you're not, you're not. But does it sort of make sense for the universe to say, you're down here to learn the lesson to line up with what I already know that I am, it's almost, it's a very odd idea.
Yeah, I guess I wasn't looking at it as an over command type situation, but as a relative situation, such that if I'm going to explain to myself that this happened for some reason that I'm giving it, and therefore I'm going to attempt to avoid that type of situation in the future, isn't that a growth impetus?
It's amazing. So it should look like this. It should look like, in this moment, this person has cut me off in traffic. Now, how did I become a match to that creation? Because everything in my reality is a creation. Granted, when you just lost your child or something like that, that's not the question you want to ask yourself. You want to ask yourself, what's a little bit better than this? But if you would like to take control of the matrix again, the question is, how did I make myself a match to that? I mean, you don't ever walk up to somebody who's just gotten out of an abusive situation in their childhood and say, oh, how'd you create that one? Oh, that's just going to push people, you know,
right,
the wrong way. So, but once you get to a certain point, it no longer feels good to be stuck in any of those lower vibrations. And the next logical step is, and it's a big pill to swallow, how did I create this? Because that question is not, how do I then take blame and feel guilty for the fact that I've lined up with this? It's, how do I make it so that my future doesn't look this way? That obviously means I have to change something within myself.
Right.
And that's exactly what the third dimension was created to do. It's created to show you what you would not like, and through what you not don't like, you know what to create that you would like.
Okay.
And comes that.
Teal, I wonder if you could speak to how I hate to use this word, but destiny plays in to, you know, when we come into this life. Are you saying that there's nothing that is set to happen? It's all random and based on what vibration we align to, or are there some predefined lessons that we came into? We wanted to learn a specific, I don't know, maybe tolerance or patience, and so we put ourselves in a situation where we could help our spirits could align with that lesson.
It's a mix of both. So when you are thinking about coming into a life, you will put forth an intention like that. I want to understand what patience is. And to understand what patience is, you know that you will have to pretend to be the opposite, and so you will choose into a life that looks like whatever it is you want to escape, you know, the antithesis of patience. And when you're in that place, you will be brought to the understanding of what patience is. But once you have created the physical you, you get to, like I said, align with or oppose that vibration and that original intention. It's just not going to feel very good to do it. So, but it's hard for people to understand because you are the person that decided into that intention, so it was your choice. But now you get the choice to align with it or not align with it, which is also your choice. So it's not like somebody else is dictating your destiny. You are the one that chose your original destiny. It's just not going to feel particularly good to you to not align with it. In fact, when we talk about alignment, let's say that you feel really good when you paint. That's going to be an indication that what you're meant to be doing down here, part of what you're meant to be doing is painting. All that is you lining up with part of your original intention.
So when something happens to, say, a child who is completely innocent, and it's painful for that child. I'm going to go there. And so you're saying that situation could have been an intention of the spirit before it came into being human to understand or to learn something. Is that what you're saying?
Oh yes, but we misunderstand innocence. This is an arbitrary thing. There's not one single being in the world that is quote unquote innocent, because your children who come in may have come in billions and billions of times. Just because they came into this life after you does not mean that they're not an eternal creator. They are creating before the sperm and the egg even meet. That focus has to be present for the sperm and the egg to even physically meet. And so they are the ones that are creating all of it as well. And they come in with powerful intentions to create physical deformities even, things that will help them align with their own expansion. But we like to, of course, look at that and say, how could something innocent deserve something like this when it's a deliberate choice? And they're no less or more innocent than those of us who are adults.
So what you're saying, it sounds like, is that we can always override, and I don't want to use this word, but I'm going to use it again, destiny. If we came in to do something and we decide once we're on the ground, so to speak, that I don't think I want to do that anymore, we can get out of it. Okay.
Oh yeah, you can get out of it. Of course you can get out of it. And that would be the destiny of you coming in. See, that's where it's kind of fun. You can't really draw a line between what's destiny and what's not destiny, because if you've come in and you've decided that it doesn't feel good to line up with whatever it is, then that wasn't your destiny to begin with. Your destiny and your purpose is inseparable from your joy. So that may change 100 times when you're down here on this planet, but it's all going to be what you meant to come down here and express.
And are there certain, is it equally as, and I'm going to use a term that you're not going to agree with, but easy or difficult? I know those are relative and it is based on judgment, but are there certain things that take more effort or less to make a right turn from? Or is it equally, if I had an absolute destiny to help a lot of people, and I decide, you know what, I don't want to do that. But all these people and all their, I'm affecting their lives by choosing not to help them.
No, you'd be affecting them if you tried to help them still. Because you cannot ever help somebody from an aspect of disconnection. So what they would do if they really desired something is create new teachers who are in alignment with that very same intention. There's universal energy here, which is absolutely unlimited. So every desire which any of you have is created within the universe. Sometimes that may look like the manifestation of a spiritual teacher at the perfect time. But if there's even a desire present, there will be a manifestation that matches it. You can be sure of it. So it wouldn't matter what you did or didn't do. A person will always find their desire the minute they line up with it. There's nobody that's going to be desiring something, lines up with it, and, oh no, we haven't created that physically in the reality yet. This matrix literally becomes the exact match of our desire the minute we line up with that desire and are sharing that same vibration. So you wouldn't have to worry about letting somebody else down based on coming in and not fulfilling your destiny according to what you first set down to do.
So when you say align with that desire, can you elaborate?
So when I say I want a relationship, but I don't think I can have it, but I don't think I can have it is the definition of not aligning with the desire. You can't be a match to the relationship you want if you're still thinking thoughts like, I don't deserve it. That would be for the universe to impose itself on free will, which is an absolute defiance of everything that exists. And it's a defiance of love. The universe loves you, which it does because you're an extension of it. Then it can't join you in your aspect of disconnection. It can't say, oh, I don't trust you to line up with something, so I'm going to give it to you anyways. To see you in your magnificence, to look at you with the eyes of Source, which it has, is to see that the minute you give rise to a desire, you have the ability to line up with it, meaning, I want that, and it's mine the minute I think it, and I'm going to get it, and I'm going in the direction of it, and there's nothing holding me back. That's lining up with it. And the minute you do that, it will manifest that fast.
Wow, thank you. That's like a puzzle piece just snapped into place almost audibly. Thank you.
Oh, goody.
Teal, I have a question. If we step in and we try to help another soul align with what we think that their purpose should be, you know, again, parent, siblings, whatever our intimate relationships are we undermining them and their ability to create?
Oh, 100%, because what do you have to be thinking if you think somebody else needs help? You have to be looking at them and focused at them and their aspect of disconnection. So what's funny is that you watch people, my favorite is people who call themselves helpers. It's a very dangerous line they're walking, because to call yourself a helper, you'd have to first think that the world needed to be helped. And that right there is a disconnection, an aspect of being out of alignment with who you really are. So walking in the room, if you see somebody ill and you align with the fact that they're ill, that's all you're feeding energy to. So the same way as you're looking at somebody and saying, oh, they need my help, you're focused at their aspect of lack. And so you're actually feeding it. Which is why you'll notice that what you would consider your great helpers, which really they don't call themselves helpers, somebody like Mother Teresa, when she walks in the room, she doesn't see a kid who's atrophying because they've been stuck in a crib in an orphanage all their life. What she sees is an infinite being who would like joy, and so she aligns herself with that joy. She does not see them in the aspect of disconnection. If she did, she'd lose her mind. So that is how to do it, quote-unquote, correctly, I guess you could say. I hate that word, but here we are restricted again with the English language. To do it the way that it was meant to be done, to be the best benefit to somebody else, you would only focus at them in their aspects of strength.
Okay, so for example, you know, if you want to help out in a homeless shelter, or you see somebody that's down and out and you want to give them food or a place to live, how do we know that they didn't come into this alignment to experience that?
Oh, they did. You can be sure that they did. If they're experiencing it, it was meant to be. That's just how it is. When we start suffering and when we start stepping out of alignment with the universe is when we think things should be different than they are. But that still is not going to erase your desire. Your desire is to see this being in enjoyment. And so maybe for you, what feels good is to go hand him a dollar. And that is you lining up with who you really are. It has nothing to do with him. So if that person sees that dollar and uses that as his excuse to line up with who he really is, that's really what we're meant to be doing here. And you can always trust your emotion to tell you accurately all the time whether what you're going to do is in the step of the right direction or not the right direction. Handing out soup at a kitchen somewhere to homeless people, if you're aligned with the problem, then you're going to start suffering quite a bit and you're going to start getting energy depletion and all of that because you're actually focused on the problem. But if you're standing there and ladling out soup and really enjoying the look on these people's faces as you're sustaining their life force, that means you're in alignment and you're going to do 10 times more good than you ever would have the other way.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Teal. In relationships, I think we like things to stay the same. We don't really know how to deal with cycles, with transitions, and we make those things wrong at times. I listened to it. It was an old quote from Dear Abby, and she said that women get married expecting the man to change, and men get married expecting the woman to never change. which of course neither of them works out. So how do we handle transitions and growing since we don't stay the same? Or how do we know when it's time to let go of something?
By trusting your internal guidance system. See, people made it their number one priority, regardless of whether they were in relationships or not, to stay in alignment all day, every day. You could not go wrong. A partner, if it was your desire from that standpoint to have a partner that stayed with you through a whole lifetime, then you would attract the one that could stay a match to not only your stasis, but also your change. It's highly likely that when you find a partner, if both of you are evolving and staying in alignment, that you will stay in alignment together. But it also needs to be okay first that to stay in alignment means so much to me that it doesn't matter who is in or is not in my alignment. I have so much love for myself that I don't need anyone else to fill up my own cup. So if anyone else is a part of this reality with me, then that is just a magic bonus. And it requires taking your teeth out of having to have your desires come in a specific shape or form that you have predetermined. So when we say, okay, this person I love, his name is Mike. Now that has to come through him. We get ourselves pushed sideways of our own internal guidance system. When we say, my most important thing in my life is my own joy, so if I'm going in the direction of happiness all day, every day, I will let the universe line me up with who is a match to my joy. That's how to go about it. It's, you go about it by pulling your teeth out of having it be about anyone else. And it's kind of ironic because humans will look at that and say, oh, that's selfish. But really, it's not selfless. It's just one of the most self-loving and thus universal loving things you can do. Because one person who's in alignment, let's say everyone's doing that, this universe is one of alignment. And you're going to meet the people who match that joy for you in your life. You won't meet the people who could ask, who could lend to your negativity if they tried. You won't even run across them. But of course that takes bravery. It takes bravery when you're growing up in a society that says something like, well, the most important part of marriage is you stay together forever. It takes a very brave person to say, you know, okay, why do I want to stay in a relationship with someone forever? It's because I think that that would make me happy. So really, happiness is the priority. So let's just take out the middleman, which is, you know, marriage, have it be about happiness, and then just let the universe line me up with whatever that looks like. See, we don't trust that that's going to happen, because what we think is going to happen when we prioritize happiness is that we're going to be happy but poor, or happy but lonely, but that's not how the universe works. When you align with happiness, all necessary conditions for that happiness comes into your life. It manifests.
Mm-hmm.
Better ways that we can never imagine.
Yeah, I guess where I get kind of stuck is... sometimes change is a good thing, and change will lead to happiness. And like I say, things transform or things go through transitions. And so I don't want to let go of something if it's just a transition, that there's something new to be created.
I'm glad you said that word. So here's your key. The answer in your life, or anybody who is struggling with that kind of situation, is to make your practice that of letting go even when you have something.
Okay.
Because the resistance is to not wanting to let go of it, and so that's basically the direction we have to go. If we release resistance to letting go and become okay with letting go, then it's more likely that we'll get what we actually desire, which is for things to stay.
Yeah, I get that. Thank you.
I can't remember who said it, but I was listening to somebody one day talk about the fact that the entire process of life is letting go, and almost like when you have a child, the whole process is one of letting go. And it's true. How do you love something and give it enough freedom that you can know what loving really is?
Yeah.
There's no way to grasp to anything. Really, change is the only thing you can hold to, is sort of the joke. The joke is, if you want something solid, then put your roots in change. Because that's the only thing that's going to be guaranteed.
Yeah. Well, I guess there's this judgment on giving up on something.
you know, like you didn't try hard enough or something.
Oh, that's because we are a society which is suckled on the milk of effort. I mean, you watch the Olympics even, and everyone who gets the medals are the ones who we're told put the most effort towards their sport. And the funny part is if you hang out with any of these Olympic medalists, they do what they love every day. To them, it's not the kind of effort it would be for the average Joe, because the intrinsic motivation for them is the joy they feel doing the sport. And it's the rest of us watching it that like to build up these big stories about the fact that the only way to get a gold medal is through effort and effort and effort and effort. But I can tell you it does not feel the same way for someone like Michael Phelps to swim a mile that it does for somebody else, because of the amount that he loves that experience. So we like to award the effort because we think that effort is what's achieving crap, but really it has nothing to do with it. Our effort, if anything, is against the grain of the way this universe is designed. So it's a misinterpretation of what's doing it. Quite often we put enough effort towards something that we finally mentally align with something, and then it comes to be, and it's really because we mentally aligned with it, but we say, oh, it's because I worked so hard.
Yeah, no.
It's another belief.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Go ahead, Shepherd Dog.
No, I was just, that's what it sounds like, is another belief. It seems when you put your trust, a desire into a belief, then that will restrict access to a wider range of frequencies, it would seem.
Exactly. So see how interesting it is. So we live in a society which is all about effort and all about stick it out and all about the best things are hard won. And it's all of these things are out of alignment with the way that the universe is created. When it's literally this simple. If you think it, it is. If you align it with it, it becomes in the physical dimension. That's as easy as it is. Everything else we're doing is just hitting balls to the universe. Okay, I'll explain that last thought. So you could think of manifesting what you want a little bit like you're trying to hit a home run. But you can't hit a home run no matter what you do. All you're doing is basically pitching balls to the universe, and it's the universe's job to hit that one out of the ballpark. So the more balls you pitch, the higher likelihood that the universe is going to hit it out of the ballpark. But you're not meant to pitch these balls with effort. You're meant to pitch them by doing what it is that you want, by giving rise to these wonderful ideas. And when you're doing that, you're in alignment, and so the whole third dimension has to shift to become the reflection of that. That's just the way it was designed.
Yeah.
So it has nothing to do with effort. I mean, most of the time when we're in effort, we're thinking, oh, it's not going to get done unless I file this 83 pages of paperwork, and that right there is effort. When it could be as easy as saying, okay, I'm going to align with this task being done, and then I'm going to be inspired towards whatever that looks like, because the universe knows the fastest way between point A and point B. It's got a much broader perspective than we do from our third-dimensional perspective. So
right.
We just don't like handing over the reins that much because we don't trust mind. We're taught that mind is an abstraction. I mean, we're born into the Newtonian theory nowadays to such a degree that it's what most of us are fed with. The Newtonian idea of a mechanical universe where thoughts are an abstraction and the brain is what's creating them. And so why trust a thought? We're convinced it's not doing much when it's really the only thing that's doing anything. And the physical action is just the joy of lining up with it in the physical dimension. I mean, it feels really good to embrace somebody in the physical dimension. It feels kind of good to get your hand dirty in the outside in the dirt sometimes.
Right.
But the physical, what we call effort, is not really meant to be what creates here. It's just meant to be you lining up with your mental creations.
Teal, I'm sorry, I have a burning question to slip in with this topic. Is you what is the aspect of letting? How does the aspect of letting go fit into manifesting? For example, if there is someone who wants to get pregnant and they are having difficulty and a lot of difficulty, and then you hear about them saying they give up, maybe they adopt, and then they get pregnant. So it seems like there is an aspect of letting go of what you want to help manifest, and how does that fit in?
So when you give rise to a desire, if you were to line up with it and believe that it, I mean, if you knew what it was, if you knew that a desire was the delivery of an idea which exists vibrationally, and if it's focused on enough and purely, i.e. you're not thinking thoughts like, but I don't think I can have it, then it would come to be in the physical dimension, then you would have no experience like what you just described. But quite often when we have desires, things like, I want to get pregnant. Now suddenly that becomes something you want so bad that you feel the need for it. And that means that suddenly you've shifted your focus to the lack of having it and what happens if it doesn't happen. And the minute that that happens, that it becomes a need, you have now focused on the lack of what you want. And so a lot of times when you release resistance to it, that's the moment of saying, oh, screw it, I don't want this anymore. You've released resistance to it, but you can't release a desire. You can amend desire, but you can never erase desire. So the minute you've given rise to a desire, like I want to get pregnant, you release resistance to it saying, oh gosh, you know, screw it. All you're doing is releasing the resistance. The thought of, but I don't think I can have it, no longer exists. So you immediately line up with vibrationally your desire. And so a lot of times people who adopt end up pregnant. But so we could say that the letting go is what we consider, I think a better word for letting go in terms of manifestation is allowing. Because when you understand the way this works, you are meant to come up with your desires. You are meant to allow the universe to create that for you any way that it wants to, because it's got access to a lot more. Let's pretend that the universe and this hologram is a giant painting. The universe has access to a lot more paint colors than you do from where you stand. So if you say, I want this thing to look this way, then let the universe assemble all of the necessary conditions, and then you allow it into your life by doing anything that makes you feel good, and then you will not be resisting the thing which you desire, and it will inevitably come to you. So letting go looks like understanding that it's not your job to create the things which you have thought. The thought itself is the creation. Now, the universe is meant to create that for you, whether it looks like this boss who's just given you a chance at a new job or a baby. Whatever the actual creation is the universe's job. And so your job, I'm coming up with the thought, universe's job, I'm going to create that thought. And now your job from there is, how do I allow myself to experience that third dimensionally? Meaning, what thoughts can I think that vibrate at that frequency with such intensity that it manifests? Because the way this universe works is, if you focus on something, eventually it manifests. And eventually is very quick. I mean, all it takes is a super strong vibration for it to manifest physically. So the more you're focusing on thoughts like, I love my life, the more times you're a match to things in the physical dimension that line up with I love my life. When you're thinking thoughts like, I suck, you're a match to all kinds of people who reinforce that thought, because they're third dimensional manifestations of that thought. It's just a lot easier for many of us to align with negative thoughts and believe those than it is to align and believe thoughts that are positive. So does that sort of make sense as to how that letting go would work?
So letting go equals surrendering resistance.
Yes. That's what we're letting go of. Yes. Letting go of it means I've given rise to this desire, and I'm going to let go of anything that pulls me in opposition to this desire. You could think of it vibrationally. If something vibrates very low and this thing that I desire vibrates very high, I need to let go of the thing which is vibrating low first. Like, let's pretend you're straddling a canyon, and you want to get from one side to the other, and so you've got hold of something on the other side, but you've also got something hold of something on this side you were on, and now you're stuck in the middle. It's like, what is it going to take for you to go from that side to this side? Let go of what you're holding on to. So what a woman in that situation where she really wants a baby might be holding on to are thoughts like, oh my gosh, what happens if I don't get it? Oh my gosh, I need this baby, meaning I'm focused on the lack of this baby. Any thought like that is going to hold you in opposition to the vibration of the end result, which is a baby. So if a woman was able to focus on the gratitude for what she has in her life already, while simultaneously focusing tons of energy mentally, it doesn't really take effort, but focusing primarily on what it would feel like to have that baby in her arms, then the universe would yield it to her immediately.
I see. Thank you.
Yeah.
Teal, what does fear energetically look like to you?
Oh, goodness. Yeah. Not so pretty.
Yeah.
It looks like a super chaotic energy. So usually it originates sort of in the bone marrow of a human being, interestingly enough. And, well, I'd say that would be basically where it resonates within the body the deepest, is in bone marrow. But the thought starts, like it does, in the body field, which is outside the body, and then it starts feeding into the heart. And the minute you watch that really chaotic, it looks a lot like static. You know, have you ever watched television? You see that when you turn it to a channel that doesn't work, it's just that really intense static.
Uh-huh.
That's sort of what it does. And so it looks like that, and then it feeds into the heart. And now the heart starts racing and starts pumping it through the bloodstream. And it starts collecting itself in the bone marrow of people. And so then, once it's reached a peak point, basically, you've got this cascade of mental chemicals that are coming down across the body. And then this person is just emitting this really chaotic energy. And it's a very low frequency energy. As low as it gets, you know, fear is basically powerlessness.
So is it your thought that all negative energy drills down to fear and lack?
Yes, basically.
Okay.
Well, because behind all anger is fear.
Mm-hmm.
Fear is the opposite of source. And we're in a contrasting environment where we're trying to realize source. So we could consider the third dimension a continuum of fear.
Okay. And, you know, so many people are afraid of death and the concept of hell. And how do you suggest that people transition that's in alignment or that feels good? And what is your thought on death?
Okay, so my thought on death, well, in my world, death doesn't really exist. Because obviously I can interact with thought forms all the time. So when people pass on, they're not really gone to me. And sometimes I have to temper myself because it's not really enjoyable to sit at a funeral and be like, oh, all chipper and happy. And everyone's looking at you, they're like, what the hell's wrong with you? Well, in my reality, all they're doing is withdrawing from a physical... Okay, let's go here. You know how you play a video game and you pick an avatar? That's really all that's happening here in the third dimension. You're picking an avatar, and so all that's happened is your avatar is gone. So when you're really outside, in the highest of perspectives, it's no more big a deal for a person to die than it is for your avatar to die in a video game. Because life continues. It can't be taken away from. There is no such thing as annihilation. It's a vibrational impossibility. But the way that I would tell people to align with death so that they're not so afraid of it is to go straight into the eye of the monster and figure out what it is that you're so afraid of relative to death. Figure out whether it's these preconceived ideas you've been fed about hell after this or judgment. Figure out what it is. Because that's different based on from person to person. Some person might be afraid of there being nothing after this life. The next person might be afraid that they're going straight to hell. I mean, it just totally varies. So once you've figured out what it is you're actually afraid of relative to the subject of death, then you can start focusing on that. And really, this is your opportunity to decide whether the beliefs you hold are your beliefs or whether they're beliefs you've picked up from other people. And then you get to really do your research, meaning look at other opinions, really think about it. And you'll start to come into alignment with thoughts which don't look like the ones you're holding right now.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Teal, how have you arrived at all your gems of wisdom?
Well, some of them I came in with, and others I just...
What do you mean by came in with them? What does that mean?
So, coming into this life, I guess, this is, of course, really difficult because we could be calling the same color purple, but ultimately be talking about a different color.
Sure.
I can't really assert that I know how every single human being is, but in general, I've gathered that it's not very normal for people to remember creating their body and all of these things. But that's exactly what came in with, is the knowledge of. So let's pretend that you, from your adult awareness, let's pretend that you remember the whole process of not only picking your life, but how you came into life by activating the vibration, and remember the sensations of the egg that was you dividing and implantation and growing in your mother's womb and delivery and sitting in a diaper and all of that from an adult perspective. Mm-hmm. That's kind of what it was like for me. So a lot of these understandings I came in with, but I opted into picking up the vibrations of a lot of things that were going on in my environment so I could be a match to what I went through as a child. And then since then, I've just treated my whole life like it's a teacher. There's not one single interaction, whether it's an interaction between me or and somebody super enlightened, or an interaction between me and a cup. It's all... There's, because every single interaction you have, regardless of what it's with, has meaning. So when you start looking at it that way, then you start learning from every step you take. And you don't really need a teacher. It's just you're learning all the time.
Right.
So it came about that way. And I can tell you a lot of the stuff that I came to came out of the suffering I went through as a child, for sure.
Yeah. I can believe that quite easily. And has some of it come from your guidance as well? Because you spoke about your guides, and is there anybody else that has influenced you? Or
yeah, I think my principal guide does quite a bit. I don't really sit down for lessons with him, but I can tell you when I go through struggles, I for sure definitely call on him. And he gives me as frustrating an answer as I give people, of course. That's it.
Wow, I'm just quite amazed is what you've brought in, and thank you.
Thank you. It's always exciting to hear that people can understand some of this stuff, because I worry when I'm using language a bit. I really love language, but sometimes it can be quite restrictive when you're trying to understand concepts that are this outside the box.
Well, I mean, I struggle with that myself, and I know others around me struggle with it, and sometimes there are no words for all of this, and sometimes we have to paint and make music and poetry and whatnot to try to convey things that, so maybe we better start creating some words that we can share, huh?
Oh, that'd be good.
Well, there you go, write a book about it.
Teal, I had a question about how nature has played into your learning and your experience.
Oh, quite a bit, I guess, because I grew up in the middle of nowhere. We'll just put it that way. Middle of nowhere meaning that in the summers, my closest neighbor was like 50 miles away. I was in the wilderness in a two-room cabin with no electricity. And so my parents are serious environmentalists. So we were kind of raised with the idea of communion with the natural world. I don't know how much it influenced the way I think, because it just, I don't really see a difference between human and nature. But I think that you can see a lot of these greater truths reflected in nature. For example, plants are some of the most allowing beings that there are. It's not like they protest when they're cut down. You know?
Yeah, I guess, I mean, I live next door to a horse pasture, and there was a doe with three fawns, so she had adopted, and they were all late. They were all small towards fall, and they'd been coming, and I was taking pictures and enjoying them, and then something got them.
Yep.
I mean, there was one left, and he was injured, and he finally died under a hedge. And I was like, what does that mean? You know, and what I came to was coyotes need to eat, too. Mm-hmm. You know, and but I know that you're watching nature, you can, I guess there's no wrong with nature. It doesn't have the same judgments and labels on it of good and bad.
Yep. Yeah, that's a human device, that kind of an ideal. it's just, so here's the thing. When the third dimension is first created, there's many times, a great many times, when we tried out different ways of being here. What we found is, if we don't come into a vibration of something like a survival mechanism, then nothing's going to stay here very long. But on top of that, the minute that you make it so that something comes into the vibration of survival, you automatically, in that thought, have created something that it needs to survive. And that's what got this whole ball rolling. And that's actually part of what we're doing, getting out of this whole thing, is coming into a vibration where that survival really has nothing to do with eating and being eaten. There are places within this universe where that's not even a construct anymore. You literally take your energy. It's free energy. When we say free energy, right now we're thinking, oh, how do we get cars around without having to pay oilmen? But free energy is much bigger than that. It also means, how do you get energy without having to take it from a plant or an animal and eat it? And there are places in this universe where that's already been mastered. So there's no need to take from anything else and take from something else's joy to align with your own survival. So part of what that interaction you had was meant to do was align you with what you would prefer, which is that nothing had to eat anything.
Yeah. I was disturbed by that.
Yes. Then you have to ask, what belief in me made me a match to seeing that circumstance?
That's a good question.
Because not everyone lines up with that experience.
Yeah, because coming to the place of being peaceful with it felt good.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd prefer to have not seen it. It was nicer to just have the fawns that got adopted.
Oh, yes, I agree.
Yeah.
So what you did is find a better feeling thought. A better feeling thought looks like the coyotes have to eat too.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's even better than that? See how we're moving up the vibrational scale even relative to thoughts? Isn't it fabulous?
Mm-hmm.
See, all you have to do is believe in victimhood, and you're a perfect match to seeing babies getting eaten. Any belief that we have that something can be taken advantage of is going to line us up with proof of that effect.
Yeah. Yeah, because then my other thought was, is they were too small going into winter, and they may have had a hard time, and maybe it was a good thing for them.
Well, that's a good thought, yes. I mean, anything that makes you feel better relative to the situation is going to pull you more into alignment with your higher perspective.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, what we're looking for is for you to make yourself a match to what you want entirely and stop making yourself a match to even seeing that aspect of the reality in the first place. You'll notice that people who are avid activists tend to line themselves up with these cases all day. So the person, let's say that there's a person who's really worrying about the state of the world. They're always the person who passes the puppy who's dead on the street. They're always the person who lines up with that kind of stuff because that's their reality, and their focus about the universe is that it's unjust and unfair. And so those kinds of thoughts make you a match to that kind of manifestation.
Okay.
So if collectively we were not manifesting that, you literally could not see three fawns come in and all be killed.
Mm-hmm. Well, and this year that didn't happen. That happened last year.
Yeah, and of course... That would make sense because you released a little bit of resistance.
Yeah, this year I had fox puppies born in the blackberries, and they were playing, and that was so much fun.
Uh-huh. That's my spirit animal.
Oh, yeah. Very fun. Another kind of question, as you look at our group, what do you see when you look at us?
Some serious creators. So, of course, there's varying degrees of this, but in general, this group is a very, what I would call, creation-based group. It's not a super allowing group. Allowing and creation are two different types of energies. So people who are creator types, they have a lot of energy to flow in the direction of whatever they're focused on. This is fabulous when they're focused on good things, not so fabulous when they're focused on things that don't feel so good, because it means you create that quick. Allowing people don't tend to create as much. Like animals are an example of allowing beings. They don't create as much in the world, but they also don't resist as much in the world, and so they're able to stay more in alignment. So the key for this particular group is, how is it that I can create using my mind, which you are all doing all day long, but also simultaneously learn how to allow so I come into alignment with that instead of think a resistant thought, so I'm not in an internal tug of war. See, if we're good creators like all of you are, and you're focused on what you do want, but you're also focused on what you don't like, you're in a tug of war. So how does the creator learn how to allow? That's the question for this group.
That's a good question. I like it.
Because you're not, if you learn to be an allowing being, it's not like you're going to sit on your butt all day long, which is what a lot of people think. Oh no, if I get rid of these things, I'm going to have no motivation and I'm going to eat ho-hos in front of the TV all day long. But that defies you coming into life in the first place. It's a vibrational impossibility. Because you all came down here with intrinsic motivation, and that's not going anywhere. You're going to sit on that couch for about 10 seconds and then want to create something else.
Is that's the creating person or the allowing person?
Creating person. We'll sit there for 10.5 seconds so creative people say, if I get into a state of allowing, I'm just going to eat ho-hos all day long and be worthless sitting on a couch. But that defies everyone. Regardless of whether you're allowing or not, you came down to here to create. And so it's not something you should worry about. You're not going to erase your intrinsic motivation just based on figuring out how to be more allowing. All you're going to do is figure out how to line up with what you've created quicker.
Okay. So, what does an allowing person look like?
A person who falls in love with everything that is. That's where the real questioning of your thoughts comes in. So, a person who is allowing is going to find a way to love the cigarette butt that's laying on the side of the road. A person who's allowing will find a way to love child abuse. Not because they want it, but because they're going to release resistance to it happening and see it in terms of the bigger perspective. And by doing that, you're coming into alignment, and therefore you're allowing your own alignment with what you actually desire, which is for all children to be born into happy homes.
Yeah, I get a thought running around in my head, lazy. You can't be lazy.
Beliefs.
Yeah. I can watch it running around, and it's obviously a belief, and it's like, oh God.
So then you have to ask yourself, am I really a person who's lazy by nature? What kind of person would I be if I didn't have the thought, I can't be lazy? Would you be a lazy person? No, in fact, the thought, I can't be lazy, is actually preventing you from lining up with a lot of the things you have created. So that thought in and of itself is making you more lazy.
Yeah, because I resist it and resent it, and then I want to have more stillness, and so I spend a lot of time being still because I'm resenting having to not be lazy.
Yes, and then you spend a lot of energy resisting, a lot of energy which could be flowing in the direction of creation.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
Teal, I understand you're working on another book.
Woo! Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Care to indulge us a bit?
Yes, indulge you. I had a really funny moment. So I was on another radio show, and there was a guy, a radio show host, who said, how important is it that we love ourselves? And of course, as usual, I'm like, oh, it's the most important thing there is. If you figure that out, you don't need to talk to me anymore. I mean, that's the end of it. That's the means by which everything else is figured out. And I sat there, and even though he's talking, I was sort of like half listening, and the other half of me was like, wait a minute. You're the kind of person who says that that's what your job... I mean, I'm always the person who says, I'm the one that goes to the root, you know? Teal's the one that goes to the root. I will attack the root every single time. And I was like, okay, I've just said that the root of all roots is self-love, and I haven't written that book yet. So I was halfway in the middle of this other project, which is going to be my ongoing project, which is a book of processes. And I was like, that's going to be my ongoing project. The book that needs to be written is a book on how to love yourself. Because we can all say, I mean, this is what gets so frustrating, is because in this reality, in the spiritual world, it's like, go love yourself. But to a person who doesn't, it's like, great, you've just asked me to solve a quantum physics theorem. So how do you get somebody to love themselves? How do I love myself? That's my book. It's giving people step-by-step instruction as to how to go about doing that thing which we keep telling them they have to do. Which is real good. I'm totally qualified to teach that journey because I walked that journey myself from self-hate into self-love, and it works. So I'm living proof.
When do you think it'll be out, Teal?
Oh, man, I don't know. It depends. Okay. It depends how fast I find a publisher, because I'm shopping for a publisher and I want a good one. So it depends on how fast the publisher can pick it up, because I'm writing this thing so fast, just like the last one, that my head's kind of spinning. It's all I want to do. I'm kind of one of those people that when I get an inspiration, I just want to lock myself for months at a time in a cabin and get it done with all in one swoop, because it just sort of flows through me just like a out-of-control river, which I love. But it should be finished pretty soon at the rate that I'm going.
Wonderful.
And then it's all about everybody else being slow.
Okay. Now, is some of this book, you know, you said it just flows through you. Is some of this coming through your guides?
No, it's just coming through me. It's my higher self. I'm kind of like a person who finds alignment with my higher self really, really quick. So mm-hmm. I'm not preventing the flow of that kind of perspective.
Okay.
So what happens is when I align myself, my higher self is basically doing what it does for all people, which is giving you the answers. And then I'm using my logical brain. I'm a very articulate person most of the time. So I can use what I'm hearing and I can try to translate it in a way that a person with a three-dimensional mind might understand that concept.
Okay.
So I'm in the intermediary between my eternal self and the rest of the world, yes.
Okay. And do you plan on hosting any seminars in the near future?
Once I finish the book, yes.
Okay. Well, we'll certainly look forward to that and would love to have you back on when your book is finished and you're ready to start talking about it.
Well, goody. You know this is my favorite subject in the world, too. I'm going to be so excited for that.
We'll be excited as well. Well, Teal, thank you very much. This has been fantastic information. I think we're still all processing and aligning with everything that you've said tonight. And thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me. You know that I love this.
Thank you. Our executive producer, Fox, provided the recording and technical support of our show this evening. You can listen to more Time Monk Radio interviews at timemonkradio.com, Time Monk Radio's Facebook page, and on Time Monk Radio's YouTube channel. On behalf of all of us at Time Monk Radio, be well.